marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have gained him the victory. The Lord has made known his salvation. His righteousness he has revealed in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his mercy and his faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of God. Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth in song, rejoice and sing praises. Sing to the Lord with the harp and the sound of a song, with trumpets and the sound of a horn. Shout joyfully before the Lord. Let the sea roar and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the hills be joyful together before the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. With righteousness he shall judge the world, and the peoples with equity. Father God, we come this morning ready to worship. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. He's here to set free. Glory to God. Sometimes you're able to hold on to what God's taking you out of because you want it, because you like something that felt good to you at that time. You remember the good, and sometimes we are really good at remembering the good and forgetting what the bad was all about. But God is bringing us out, and if we will overcome our thoughts with the Word of God and walk in what God says and hold on to Him, we will walk out of our past and into our future. Thank you. where the tornado had happened last week, and I can't remember And anyway, this man was sharing that he was in his house and the tornado was coming, and he said he started praying. And he said he had his little dog wrapped around his arm, and all of a sudden his dog was gone. And he said his house was just being taken right around him. He said, I could just see everything just being torn apart and going. And he said when it was all over, he said, I had about a 7 or 8 foot area around me. And he said, God had made a hedge.
Woo!
This is on the Weather Channel. He said, God had made a hedge around me. And he said, I said to God, okay, I'm safe. Now where's my puppy? God give him back his little dog. See how God works.
Thank you.
Chief.
Yes.
My son's got a Jack Terry Russell doll. Says Tyson's. I think all of them are. Anyway, to get to my yard and find a mole hole, or a hole hole, he goes to dig. And he digs and he falls and his toes are, gets turned down below his shoulders in that hole. Then he gets that little place where my father finished his job. You know, that's what our government's doing right now. They're digging and pushing the floors. Sometimes they find an answer, most of the time they just walk away and start on another hole. They're doing absolutely nothing, so people. They're just sitting there playing politics. They need prayer. The Bible says
yeah, prayer. Yeah, hallelujah.
And we should remember that. One day, Earl and Chuck was working together putting siding on the house. But Chuck decided he'd walk around and see what Earl was doing. And he was picking a nail up from the way. Just her name's nail. So it must be away. And finally, Chuck said, Earl, what are you doing? We said the head's on the wrong end of these nails. And Chuck said, here for the other side of the house. We're starting something new. The last Wednesday night of each month, instead of Bible study, we're having prayer meeting.
Amen.
We still have a song service. And announcements and things, and then instead of having Bible study, we'll pray. Now we Bible study for about 35, 40 minutes, so we expect to pray that long.
Amen.
And we'll do it different ways, we pray separately, we get together and pray. But you know, you can do a lot more when you all together pray for something.
Amen.
We're glad that individuals for different things.
Yes.
So let's work with this. Be here by all means.
Yes.
And, now, I'll be honest, sometimes when I pray, I go to sleep. But I thank the Lord bless me anyway. But let's get with it. The prayer is needed very, very bad.
Yes.
Yeah.
Our people are, what? Lethargical, is that the word I want to say? They're not into it. They need to be stirred up, each one of us. And those who come here need a blessing.
Yeah.
Too much sickness going on.
Yeah.
So let's try your best to be here. The first night will be the 22nd. Then we go into June. Women's Ministry in the second of June, Women's the Alabaster Box, and then Parents' Dinner or after the AM service. Someone's running out of reckon, so they ask you for something, do your best to help out. 7th and 8th is a disciple workshop in Wilsonville. 16th is Father's Day. 24th of June to July 2nd is the General Convention of the 5th of Texas. Our pastor will be going. That's a great one. Why is there? Now, I've heard that he gets a little contentious sometimes. So pray that the Lord will keep a hand on him and keep him, you know, mild man.
I learned from Brother Muzzarelli.
All right.
That's the problem. Okay, well, we pray for both of them now. But they can have a good time, but there is a need for a general convention. We're going to July event that's far away. I can't even think about it. Brother Otto, have you received the offering? Brandon, would you help me this morning?
Thank you.
jurisdiction. Seek your face continually, Lord. Lord, now we thank you for this offering. May you bless it for the 10 years in your name. Amen.
This is kind of an ad lib thing, but just pray with, you know, sometimes your soul needs fighting. We are against ourselves in so many ways. Sometimes we just have to go to the cleft of the rock. This is one of my favorite hymns to be sung throughout my life, and it's one of my favorites.
Thank you. Would you testify this morning?
Amen.
It is truly good to be here. And I've already mentioned to several of the folks, we had several reasons for coming this direction. And one of our great-granddaughters is graduating from high school this afternoon. We did not want to miss the opportunity to be at Abundant Life, the church. Always enjoy being here, always enjoy this fine fellowship and the Spirit of the Lord. And I have been blessed already this morning, and I'm looking forward to a great message from the pastor.
Amen.
Well, I have to agree with my husband. It's always good to be here and be among friends and to feel the presence of the Lord. And I told Sister Mary and Sister Pat when we were standing out in the foyer, I was going to quit telling everybody it was our great-granddaughter that was graduating from high school because that makes us old. But Sister Pat informed me I am not old. So, there you go. I'm not old. But I do love the Lord, and I thank Him for His faithfulness to us, and I just pray that I can be faithful to Him.
Hallelujah. For those of you who don't know, Brother Muzzarelli is our district secretary, and Sister Barbara is our Women's Ministry Secretary for the Illinois District.
And I do have a message for Brother Smith in light of the comment you made earlier. At one convention, my wife threatened to put glue on my seat.
So we're not going to let her go this time. She don't get to go. It's a shame. I would love to have her be with us at that time that we're going to be down there. So we've got a lot of things to do, a lot of things that the general board is going to be working on and doing. So pray for us, because it's a time of reorganizing who we are and what we are. So it takes a whole lot to do that. But just pray about that, if you would. Turn with me to the 12th chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians. First Corinthians chapter 12. The Apostle Paul wrote in verse 1, it says, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you to be ignorant, knowing that it is important for us to understand that God has a plan for the church."
Yes.
"And that we are not to take lightly the moving and the operation of the Holy Spirit within our lives. Sometimes we get caught up in that humdrum religiosity of just coming to church, singing a few songs, listen to a sermon, and go back out the door, and we're the same as we were when we came in."
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And little by little, I see across not only this church, but many churches, and I watch things on TV and I read articles of how the church is becoming dead.
Uh-oh.
The lack of an operation of God within the church. If the Bible tells us in the last days, we're going to come to the place that we're going to profess the power of God, profess Christianity, profess being Christian, but will deny the power that empowers us to do that life. So that when we're outside of these walls, it's easy to be a Christian when you're here because everybody's watching you. But when you go outside the walls, when you get in your car, when you're at home, when you're on the job, see the people still watching, but it's not church people, and they're over here doing that, and they're over here doing this, and they pay no attention to what you were doing. I was watching on the news, and this man had, up in Chicago, had decided that he did not want drug dealing to go on in his neighborhood. And they threatened the man's life. They told him if he didn't shut his mouth, they were going to kill him. So he got him a camera. I can imagine Earl doing this. Got him a camera, stood inside of the room where he was at, threw a little crack in the window, and started videotaping drug deals the people that were buying, the people that were selling, and he gave all this information to the police. And he told these people, he said, I'm going to be doing this, and again, they threatened to take his life. He said, you know, you can't take my life. I don't quit living just because you kill me. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, you know, without fear, he said, I don't care what you're doing. And within a time period, the drug dealers, they moved to another block. They're somewhere else still doing it. But the block that he lives on is clean. And it was in front of a Baptist church that he was watching them sell these drugs all the time. And he said, I got upset. He's an Islamic man. And he says, I got upset because they were standing in a place that represented God, selling drugs. And I wonder in our life, if we have that kind of boldness, the Bible tells us in Acts that the Holy Spirit would come upon us and it would give us power, it would give us boldness, it would give us strength to perform the things that God has set before us to perform. And we watch our life, and are we really performing the miraculous things that the Holy Spirit is capable of performing through our life?
Think about it.
Or do we just go to church and go back home and go to church and go back home and nothing is happening? We're watching our neighbors go to hell. We're watching the people we work with go to hell, and we don't say a word to them. We're watching family members go to hell, and we don't say a word to them. We don't want to upset them. We don't want them to think that we, you know, are picking on their lifestyle. I'm sorry about that. The Bible tells us to compel them to come in. That literally means to wrap them up, tie them up, and drag them into the kingdom of God. And that is what the Bible is teaching us to do. But we, the born-again believers, believer, are no longer working the works of God. We're content to watch them live the lifestyle that they're living without even saying anything.
Yes.
We don't want them not to like us.
Oh.
Jesus, I think at times he should have got the book How to Win Friends and Influence People. Because when he went into the temple and they were not doing what God had ordained for that temple to do, and he went into that temple and they weren't doing that, he let them know that what you are doing is not what God ordained this place to be. He let them know that what you are doing is not what God ordained to do. When you sacrifice that lamb, here's a pattern that God told you to do that, not to take money from people for all these different things, but he performed a miracle working power in the life of salvation through the animals for thousands of years, looking forward to the coming of Jesus Christ. And he let them know, you're not doing it. Church today, the church of Jesus Christ around this world is not doing what God had ordained for the church to do.
Come on, yeah.
We are not winning souls. It tells us in Matthew 28, baptizing them and making disciples out of them, and we are not doing that.
Come on.
The church is sitting back on its haunches and doing nothing in the fullness of all of that. And I'm not talking just here at Abundant Life. I'm talking about the church around the world. Places like China, where they have to give their life if they're caught doing what we're doing here today. They're winning more souls over there than we are in the United States of America.
Think about it.
We got a book in the mail the other day from the Voice of the Martyrs, a pastor's wife, and how they, in Russia, and how, what they had to suffer and death and everything else that they had to endure so that they could proclaim the gospel of Jesus. Around the world, there are pastors, there are missionaries, there are people that are proclaiming the truth of Jesus Christ, and they don't know from day to day whether they're going to be killed or not.
Amen.
We just don't really know what is going on around about us in the world. We don't know what is happening out there. We listen to CNN, and we listen to Fox, and they just tell us what they want us to hear. There's another news network, if you can get into it on yours, and it's a Christian news network. And you'll find out what's going on in our world.
Yeah.
We know what's going on in their world. But do you know what's going on in the world of Jesus Christ? the church and the life that you and I are part of, the families that we are part of, the ministry that we are part of, those that God has set us as brothers and sisters around the world. Do you really know what's happening to your brothers and sisters in the world? The Voice of the Martyr, they have a tremendous magazine. If you want that information, I can get that for you, because in there, it'll tell you how they're being persecuted. It'll tell you around the world what is going on. Christians that have to literally lay down their life for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lay down their life and, literally watch their children be killed in front of them. And they take this one family, had half a dozen kids, and they said, "You're going to deny Jesus Christ before we're through with it." They killed one of his child, one of his children. They said, "Will you deny Jesus now?" "No." "Killed another." "Well, now will you deny him?" "Killed another." "Now will you deny him?" "Killed all of his children." And he said, "I still will not." Then they turned to his wife, and they said, "If you do not deny him, then she is the next one to die." And she turned to her husband, and she said, "Though they take my life, stand on what you believe for the Lord Jesus Christ. Though they take our life, they cannot stop the work that we have already accomplished in this land." And we here in America, we sit back and don't do anything. And the Bible says, don't be ignorant of the spiritual gifts that belong to you.
Yeah.
God has given you this power. He has given you the strength. He has given you the ability to speak. If you don't know, the Bible says, if you don't know what to speak, ask God and he will tell you. If you don't know how to witness to somebody, ask God and he will tell you. We're going to start these prayer meetings on the last Wednesday night of the month. Come and join us for that, because that is your power.
Yes.
That is the power under the gift of the Holy Spirit that he wants us to operate in and work in. We need to set on fire ourselves. We need revival. Not an evangelistic outreach. We need a revival in the church of God.
Yes. Amen.
When we see us content and just having a good church service and going home and forgetting about it for the rest of the week, there's a real problem going on in the house of God.
Amen.
And listen, I'm not just talking here in Abundant Life. I'm talking about churches around our country that have no concern about winning souls, or whether their family are in church, or whether their kids are in church, whether their parents are in church. They don't really care about any of that. The commission that Jesus gave us was to win souls.
Yes.
Then he tells us in Acts, "And I'll empower you to do so. I'll empower you to do the work that I have set before you to do. If you can't, you don't think I can do this, I can't do that, I can't do this, and I can't do that." The old saying is, "Well, can't never did do anything." Because if we don't try, how do I know how to witness? Tell them what Jesus did for you. If you can't do nothing else, if Jesus has saved you, if Jesus has worked in your life, if Jesus has changed things in your life, you've got the best Bible in the world, because they cannot deny what took place in your individual life. They can deny the Bible, they can deny the book, they can deny whatever we say in the church, but when it's you yourself and you're standing there and this is what happened to me.
Yes.
Hallelujah,
yes.
Hallelujah.
The boldness that we need. The Bible says enter into the throne of grace boldly. Why isn't miracles taking place in your life? Why isn't the relationship with God where it belongs in your life? Because you don't do nothing bold. We were sitting having a sandwich yesterday with Brother Sister Buzzarelli, and we were kind of talking about Mary and listening to what Mary was doing, and me and Barb looked across the table at each other and said, "You know, nothing's going to stop her. She's going to do it anyhow. She's going to do what she knows she can do, and she's going to push it to the limit in what she can do. The only reason she didn't come to the church 5 days after, 6 days after she had her surgery, is because she didn't think she could leave the house. As soon as she found out that she could leave that house, she was at church. She was here on Sunday, she was here on Sunday night, she's been here Wednesday night, And, you know, she's walking on one leg, basically. Three legs, four legs, five legs, you know what I'm saying. But you don't give up. Oh, it's my nap time. Not yet, you got another half hour. But to do what God has set before the church to do. And He's empowered us to do that.
Yeah.
If He's given us the ability to do that, He's given us the Holy Spirit. One of the biggest problems the church has today is the fact that the majority of our people, they say 70% of our people, 70% of the people that go to a Pentecostal church are not baptized in the Holy Spirit.
Wow.
How can we keep calling ourselves Pentecostal? If the people don't have a Pentecostal experience,
think about it.
If it is not happening, if people are not being filled with the Holy Spirit, if we don't have people speaking with the evidence of an unknown tongue, if we don't have the gifts of the Spirit working, if that is not taking place within the church, how can the church continue to say we're Pentecostal and we don't act like it? We don't represent. We don't manifest the working of the Holy Spirit. Shouting, isn't it? The other day I was around somebody and I heard them shouting louder than you folks shout, but they were arguing with each other. And they didn't care who was around them. They didn't care what was going on around them. They were in this thing between the two of them, and they didn't care who in the world or where they were at or who heard them do anything. Sometimes we Pentecostals are so afraid that people are going to see us become radical. They're going to see us get out of control. The church several years back now, 30, 40 years back, got so afraid of the wildfire Pentecostals. They were so afraid that wild Pentecostal shouting, running the aisles, jumping up and down, doing flips in the church, roaming on the floor, doing the fish flops on the floor, and all that kind of stuff that was going on. Everybody was so afraid that was going to happen in their church that they just stopped.
Ouch.
Don't want no fire. If that may take place in our church, we don't want no fire in our church. And as little by little, the flame become less, the flame become less, and the flame become less, and the flame become less. Today we're lucky if there is a little flicker of fire within the churches. We're lucky if there's any kind of spark at all in the majority of our churches that call themselves Pentecostal. And the reason is because they're afraid that somebody isn't going to like that kind of meeting going on. They're so afraid that somebody's going to stomp their feet or shout or scream or holler. You know, somebody was here one time and, you know, they asked me about Sister Pat. And, you know, she's not here, but she knows about it. They said, why did she yell like that? She sings, I've got a fire burning in me.
Yeah.
And I can't contain that. She can't contain that. She can't contain that excitement. She can't contain the zeal that says, let it go! And the church, sometimes you need to understand that that's what the Holy Spirit wants to do. He wants to come in here and He just wants to let it go.
Come on.
He wants His power unleashed.
Yeah.
He don't want us to say, well, I'm proper and I'm dressed and I look so good and I don't want my hair to get messed up. I remember back in years when I was young and they come to church and they had their hair all up in a bun and all tied up in there, and they get up in the front of that church and they start jumping, hair would just go everywhere. Don't say it, letting your hair down. That's really what it was all about. They come in there, they had hair down to their waist, and they had it all balled up on their head. By the time they got through dancing in the Holy Spirit, shouting in the Holy Spirit, It's like the pit bull in the backyard. That train only go that far. And that's as far as that train is going to let that dog go. It's a good enough train. And people can come in that yard and they can stay that far away from that dog and it'll jump at them and jump at them and jump at them and jump at them. And they look at it and say, ah, you can't bother me. But that chain's not strong enough to hold them. If that chain did have a little weak link in it, and that dog could pull on that hard enough to snap that one link, that enemy that came in that yard better watch where they're at, because they're in for some trouble. Church, we need to understand, Satan has allowed the Church of Jesus Christ to be on a chain, and that's as far as he is allowing you and me to go, and he don't want us to go any farther, because he knows if we go any farther, we'll defeat him, we'll defeat his work in our family, we'll defeat his work in the church, we'll defeat his work in this country, we'll defeat his work all around us. And as long as you're willing to go as far as that chain and know that's as far as you can go, and not try to break loose from it, he'll let you live your life, let you go to heaven, and let everybody you know go to hell. What does God want us to do? How are we going to turn loose and allow God to work in our life? Tells us down there in verse 27 of 1 Corinthians 12. Now you are the body of Christ and members individually. And God has appointed these in the church, apostles, prophets, teachers, miracle workers, gifts of healing, health, administration, various types of tongues. And how often are we seeing these things take place? How often are we seeing the power of God work within the church? The gifts of the Holy Spirit back in verse 8. And to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit. To another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit. To another gift of healing by the same Spirit. To another, working the miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discerning of spirits. To another, different kinds of tongues. To another, interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit working all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills. What is God looking for? God is looking for not somebody that is necessarily capable of doing something, but willing to be a vessel.
Amen.
Willing to allow Him to do something in their life. Allow Him to take over. Here's the gift that I want to give you. Oh God, but I didn't want that. I wanted the other one. That's our attitude about everything. Sometimes when we give the little kids something, no, that's just what I want. I want that one. We are so used to eating the smorgasbord, buffets, that we can pick out, pick out, pick out, pick out, pick out. You know, very rarely we ever go to a restaurant where you sit down and you're stuck with whatever they give you. And God says, here's what I want you to have. Here is what I want you to have in your life. Are you willing to accept the gift that God has made for you? It may not even be one of those nine gifts. It may be one of these others down here. There's other things. There's health ministries. There's all kinds of things that administrations. There's all kinds of different things that are you're capable of doing. And God said, I want working within the body of Christ. I want these things working in my church. What are you willing to allow God to say, this is the one I want you to do? This is what I want you to do. Here's how I want you to do it. There's when I want you to do it. Have you become complacent? Has the Church of Jesus Christ come to the place that we are complacent? We think 1 hour on Sunday morning is enough for us to go to church? When I was a teenager, we went to church Sunday morning, stayed there all day Sunday. We lived too far away, there wasn't a car to take us home, so we spent Sunday afternoon at church. Went to church Sunday night, usually got home somewhere around 11 o'clock Sunday night. Went back to church on Tuesday night, went back to church on Thursday night, Saturday night was youth night. We were all alone. Why was there a move of the Holy Spirit in the 40s and 50s that we're not seeing in this generation? It's because we had the commitment to be in the house of God every time the house of God was open, and we wanted it open more and more and more and more and more, and we stayed there. Sometimes we would get to that altar, and we would pray at that altar for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We would stay at that altar, and we would pray. People would stay there and pray until they were endued with the power from up on high, and when they got that power from up on high, they get to just go back and sit in their pew and just be happy that they got what they had. When I got baptized in the Holy Spirit, my best friend, Donnie Bauer, and I received the baptism the same night. We had Brother Anderson, who was our general PYPA leader, there holding revival service for us. 6 weeks he was there. We got our schoolwork done. We still passed our grades. We got good grades in school, and we still did that, and we were there every night at that revival for 6 weeks. And that night we received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I was a very backward child. I would talk to people. People come into my house, visit with my family. I'd sit over in the corner as far as I could sit in the corner on a chair or something and just let them do whatever they want, or I'd sneak outside under our red hole tree, and I'd go out there and play in the dirt while they were in there because I didn't want to ground them. 14 years old, God baptized me in the Holy Spirit, and He changed me. He gave me the ability and the boldness to speak His word. Gave me the ability and the boldness to stand where I needed to stand and to be what I needed to be so I could witness to my friends. And we brought our friends to church. You want to be my friend, you're going to come to church with me. I'm not going to that place with you. Here's where my friends hang out. Here's where my friends are. Here's what we do. We don't go down there and do that. We don't go down there and do that, and down there and do that, and down there and do that. Here's what we do. We stand in the house of God. We serve Jesus Christ with all that is within us. We believe that God saved us. We believe that God sanctified us. We believe that God baptized us in the Holy Spirit. And here we are. This is our life. And if you want to be my friend, this is where you're going to be my friend. I broke loose from that chain at 14 years old. And I'm not about to let Satan stop me now. I'm not about, just because I've reached over 70 years old, my body won't get out and do what it used to do, but that's all right. I can still do a lot, and I can still share Jesus Christ. And if you ask for me to pray for you in the middle of Walmart, I'll pray for you in the middle of Walmart. And if somebody down the aisle hears me pray for you, they're just going to hear me pray for you. If you ask me to pray for you down here on a street corner in the middle of Danville, I don't care what they say, I don't care what the cops say, I don't care what the things say in town, whether you're allowed to do that or not, I'll still pray for you on that street corner. Because I'm not ashamed of Jesus Christ. And I believe the working of the Holy Spirit needs to start working in more lives.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit needs to start changing and moving you, breaking you loose from that chain so that you can actually do what God set in your life to do. Some of you have been called by God and you're sitting back and saying, well, whenever He wants me to do it, I guess He'll push me through the door. You don't need to wait until He pushes you through the door. You just get up and walk through that door. Start walking through that door and move into where God wants you to be. Receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Receive the anointing from God. Receive the calling from God and do what He wants you to do. That's what He's promised to you and me and everybody that believes. To everybody that believes, I will give power, first off, to become children of God. And become children of God, you're going to become like Him. You're going to become as He is. You're going to become as God is. And you're going to have that spiritual boldness to tell Satan life. Back off from it. When the demons come after Jesus, when he went across the Sea of Galilee into the land of the Gergesenes, he got up there with his demon coming out of the tomb, seeing him afar off, and they said, wouldn't it be a great thing that that's what happened? You get enough of the anointing of the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. When the demons come to give you a rough time, they go, I can't do that.
Come on.
And you come to torment us before our time. I love to torment them. I love to chase demons. I love them. You know, I told you a few weeks ago, this lady come to our house and spent a week in there. And she said, you know, she didn't know she wanted to commit suicide. She didn't know what was going on. She couldn't sleep. She couldn't rest. She couldn't get her mind off of all the things. And she slept the entire weekend. She said there was peace there.
Yeah.
And my son Ed told her, you don't need to worry about demons in my mom and dad's house, because they won't walk through this door. They know you. The demons that in the book of Acts said, Paul, I know Jesus, I know who do you think you are? I know who I am. I'm a child of the living God. I'm a spirit-filled believer, and I believe I've got the power of the Holy Spirit to defeat any demon that will come my way.
Yes.
And this is what God wants in His church. And folks, this is what God wants for you. If you haven't got that kind of spiritual boldness in your life, I invite you to come up here and stand this morning. Let's pray. I want spiritual boldness.
Yes.
I want the Holy Spirit anointing.
Yes.
I want the power of God working in my life.
Yes.
And I want to be able to chase demons, not have demons chase me.
Come on.
Amen.
Yes.
Would you come, please? Would somebody play something? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Power. I want the power of the Holy Spirit working. I want to sister Gloria to sing.